Hello, I'm Professor Ann Stevens, your instructor for this hybrid course on poverty, inequality, and public policy. Remember that throughout this course, you should view each video module and complete the associated homework prior to each week's face-to-face meetings. That way, you will be ready to discuss the issues and prepare for the weekly policy writing assignments. Before we can talk in any concrete way about poverty, and certainly before we can talk about policies that increase or decrease poverty, we need to have a measure of poverty. There are many ways to measure poverty, and each has advantages and disadvantages. As an economist who studies poverty, I would define poverty as a state in which individuals or families do not have adequate resources to meet their basic needs. This is close to a standard dictionary definition of poverty, the state of one who lacks a usual or socially acceptable amount of money or material possessions. It's easy to see how reasonable people could disagree when it comes to implementing or using either of these fairly simple definitions. How do we define and determine adequate, or what constitutes a basic need? How should we measure resources? What counts as a resource? And how do we determine what is socially acceptable with respect to the dictionary definition? All of these questions can lead to potential disagreement and are important to think about when we consider measures of poverty. In this module, we'll cover the basics of what any poverty measure must consist of and focus on some of the details of the measure currently used by the U.S. government. Let's begin by asking what we want from a poverty measure. As I mentioned, we want to capture whether an individual or family has adequate resources to meet their basic needs. This suggests immediately that any poverty measure will consist of two parts, a measure of resources and a threshold or poverty line designed to signify an adequate or socially acceptable level of those resources. For the resource measure, income is commonly used, but there are other choices. Most individuals receive some weekly or monthly or annual income from earnings, gifts, government transfers, and other sources. We often track income in the U.S. for tax purposes and other planning, and so income is one potential measure of resources. An alternative to income, however, might be something that comes closer to actual physical resources that meet individuals' needs, food, shelter, or clothing. Some income, after all, may not be spent in the current period and so may not contribute to meeting our current needs. Measures of consumption or expenditures are one way to avoid this concern. Why might measures of income versus measures of consumption provide different conclusions about an individual's ability to meet basic needs? Some individuals may have low income but not be lacking for any basic needs if they have wealth or savings that can be used to make purchases or to finance consumption. Retired individuals can sometimes fall into this category. Many simple measures of poverty based on income ignore such situations, but it's important to consider the possibility of using not just income, but also consumption, expenditures, or wealth to capture the resources available to individuals. Once we agree on how to measure resources, and more about the details of that will come soon, we also need to consider how much is enough, a threshold often referred to as a poverty line. One expert defines the poverty line as the cost of a bundle of goods needed to assure a minimum level of welfare. That's just another way of saying the poverty line signals just how many resources are needed to meet an individual's basic needs. Next, let's look in more detail at these two parts of a poverty measure, using the U.S. official measure as an important example. Our official poverty measure compares income to a family needs level. Specifically, income is defined as cash income from all possible sources. Because we only include cash income, this does not include any in-kind benefits such as vouchers for food or housing, like food stamps. It also would not include a company car or free tickets to sporting events or free medical care. Our official definition of income for measuring poverty is also on a pre-tax or gross basis. We do not subtract from income taxes that have to be paid to the national, state, or local governments. We also do not add to income tax refunds or credits that some low-income households may receive. Because taxes are not a voluntary form of spending, some would argue for subtracting them from income in a poverty measure to get closer to a concept of disposable income. In the U.S. official measure, however, taxes are included. This pre-tax cash family income is compared against a needs level or poverty threshold developed in the 1960s to capture the level of income needed to meet basic needs. It's adjusted for differences in family size and in the age structure of the family. We'll discuss that threshold in more detail a bit later. First, however, let's consider in more detail the income part of the official measure. This slide shows some major sources of income that do and do not count as income for purposes of the U.S. official poverty measure. Earnings, salaries, and wages do count, as do benefits from former employers like pension payments or welfare payments. Dividends or earnings from investment also count in our measure of pre-tax cash income. As I mentioned, some resources that are given to individuals in non-cash form do not count. For example, the program many of us know as food stamps, but officially named the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, or SNAP for short, provides many individuals with vouchers or electronic benefits that can be used only for food. Because these are not cash or cash-like and can only be used for certain types of consumption, they are not counted as income in the official rate. Similarly, many individuals in the U.S. receive housing assistance either by having the right to live in a house or apartment whose rent is directly paid or subsidized by the government, known as public housing, or by receiving a voucher for rent that can be turned over to a landlord. Finally, a tax credit, such as the Earned Income Tax Credit, or EITC, that is received only after income taxes are filed, is not counted as income. Similarly, we do not subtract taxes paid from income when measuring poverty under current U.S. methods. Besides income, the other piece of the official measure is the poverty threshold, or needs level, as it is called in the U.S. Here, we use needs measures that are adjusted for family size and the age of family members to account for different consumption needs of children and the elderly. These thresholds are intended to capture the amount of income needed to meet basic needs for families with different numbers of individuals. In the U.S., this threshold was developed many decades ago. In 1960, a government economist by the name of Molly Orshansky was asked to investigate the issue of how much income was needed for essentials. She began by looking at an existing document from the Department of Agriculture, known as the Economy Food Plan, and meant to be an example of the most cost-effective way to provide basic nutrition for a family. The assumptions behind this plan included no eating at restaurants, that it would be followed only for temporary or emergency use, that it required fairly careful planning and storage to minimize food waste, and that it would provide a nutritious but monotonous diet. This food plan provided a basic cost for food that varied by household size. Orshansky then did a bit more research and discovered, based on data from 1955, that an average family of three spent roughly one-third of their total income on food. Putting this fact together with the Economy Food Plan, she chose as the level of income needed to meet basic needs the cost of the Economy Food Plan multiplied by three. This was a reasonable approximation at the time, but had and has many shortcomings. Nevertheless, we've relied on these thresholds for our poverty threshold for more than 50 years, adjusting them over time only for inflation. Where are current year poverty thresholds in the U.S. set? Here, we see a chart of these thresholds as of 2013. For example, a family of five, consisting of two children and three adults, would need $28,498 to meet their basic needs according to our official measures. A single individual under 65 years of age, in contrast, would need just $12,119. Because these thresholds were developed using this very simple method, largely based on food expenditures as a fraction of total income, it's important to think about whether this approach still makes sense today. In fact, the relationship between spending on food and total spending does not look much like the relationship used by Orshansky back in 1960. The chart here shows total spending on food, along with spending on food at home and food consumed outside the home, as a fraction of per capita disposable income from 1960 to 2014. As you can see by the top line, the percent of disposable income spent on food has fallen over time, from around 17% in 1960, according to this measure, to about 10% today. This suggests that a poverty measure based on a fixed relationship with one-third of income spent on food might require some updating. Now that we know a bit about both the income component and the needs component of the official measure, there's one more detail that can be important in poverty measurement. This involves the definition of a family, the group of individuals over which income is pooled and poverty thresholds adjusted for family size are applied. Specifically, the official measure looks at income for families with a family defined as two or more people related by birth, marriage, or adoption residing in the same housing unit. This can be distinguished from two other concepts or ways of grouping individuals. Some programs and data sources refer to households, defined as all people who occupy a housing unit, regardless of their relationship. Also, as families and households have become more complex, we sometimes want to consider subfamilies, defined as married or single adults, with or without children, who live in households with another family. An example will help clarify how these definitions can affect poverty measures. Suppose, for example, there's one woman who has two children. She also has other family members in her house, a grandmother, her brother, and his child. Each of them, as shown, have the following incomes. The woman earns $5,000 per year, and the grandmother earns $10,000. The woman's brother, Homer, works full-time and earns $50,000 per year. Now, since all these people are related and living together, for statistical purposes, we treat them as one family unit. This is shown by the blue shading. This means their family income altogether is $65,000 a year, and since the poverty line in 2013 was approximately $32,000 for a family of six, they are not considered poor. Suppose, though, that Homer isn't the woman's brother, but instead is a friend who happens to live in the same house with his children. Now, there are two families in the house in this case, shown separately by the blue and gray rectangles, and they have corresponding family incomes as shown. With this simple change, family one is now in poverty, but family two is not. Neither one of these scenarios or ways of counting income is necessarily more correct. It's also not obvious that whether Homer is a brother or uncle or a friend or boyfriend should change how we count and allocate the income or what we assume about how resources are shared. This is simply one example that shows that these technical definitions can have important consequences for how we measure poverty. Since eligibility for many benefits and other assistance for low-income families often depends on this official measure or closely related measures, these technical details can have important consequences for both the individuals that depend on such programs and for government policies and spending. In the next section, we will discuss in more detail some of the shortcomings of this official U.S. poverty measure and introduce an alternative measure.